Hey, welcome back to the channel. We're known for our automotive content on the Racing for ALS YouTube, but we are really a 501c3 charity that's focused on ending ALS. Racing for ALS generates funding for Duke ALS and ALSTDI who are researching cures and treatment for this horrible disease. I'm going to share some exciting news with you from Dr. Bedlack with Duke ALS. But if you're here for our automotive content, you can always check out the latest video in the card above. They've learned a lot about ALS in the last 5 years that I've been part of ALS, the ALS community. Unfortunately, they found that there are multiple causal factors for ALS, and that means that there may need to be different treatments for each type of ALS. So Dr. Bedlack's new study is going to subset patients by genetic factors and then have a subset of different treatments that will target each one of those patients' causal factors for ALS with existing drugs. So it's using safe for human drugs that already exist, and it should produce a lot of data and hopefully lead to a breakthrough on treatment of at least some of these subtypes of ALS. Dr. Bedlack rethought the clinical trial process to target this fast-acting terminal illness that's being basically ignored by pharmaceutical companies, and it's doing valuable trials that could lead to a cure at a much smaller cost, on a smaller scale, and much more rapidly than a big pharmaceutical company could do it.
Hello, everyone. Today, I'd like to present you with a new project that I plan to start later in 2023, which is called ROAR DIGAP, a widely inclusive, largely virtual pilot trial utilizing DIGAP, which stands for Deep Integrated Genomics Analysis Platform, to personalize treatments. By way of background, my thinking about ALS research has really changed over the past 22 years. Early in my career, I was struck by the low enrollment rate in most ALS trials. I did some surveys and I learned about the importance of engaging patients as partners rather than treating them as subjects. And I started something called ALS Clinical Research Learning Institute's crash courses to help patients and families understand the vocabulary of research and how to read a research paper and what statistics mean to allow them to be better equipped partners. I learned that many patients are interested in what I call alternative and off-label treatments, especially those that are associated with ALS reversals, cases in which a person with a confirmed diagnosis of ALS progresses, becomes disabled, and then unexpectedly recovers, in some cases, most or all of their lost motor function. I started a program called ALS Untangled to try to help people living with ALS make more informed decisions about these kinds of products. I learned that many patients cannot or will not participate in your typical pharma-sponsored trials. Part of this is because the small signals that are being sought in these trials necessitate very narrow inclusion criteria, which exclude most people with this disease. Part of this is because of travel burdens. Part of it is because some people with this terrible, disabling, life-shortening disease will not accept the possibility of taking a placebo for 6 or 12 months in a trial. In partnership with patients, I started something called ROAR, Replication of ALS Reversals Trials. These are studies of alternative and off-label treatments that are associated with ALS reversals. And unlike your typical pharma-sponsored trial, these are widely inclusive, largely virtual, and not placebo-controlled. They're historically controlled. Patients serve as their own controls. I've now completed two of these unusual ROAR trials, one in which I studied a supplement called Lunacin, and another in which I studied a supplement called Therapies. While these trials did not confirm benefits from the supplements being studied, they were some of the fastest enrolling trials in the history of ALS. And they were accomplished for a fraction of the cost of a typical pharma-sponsored trial. These are in the $250,000 to $300,000 range, whereas most phase one and phase two pharma-sponsored trials cost multiple millions. And so, in my opinion, the next step in trial evolution came around because of thinking about why these trials keep failing to show benefits. So most of the ALS trials that we've done in the past 100 years, including my ROAR trials, have not found that their products were beneficial. And I'm starting to think that one reason that might be is because ALS is almost certainly not one disease. We know that 12 to 15% of ALS cases have a genetic cause. And even amongst that small percentage, there are 40 different genes that can cause the disease. We know that patients with the disease look very different from each other in terms of their age and site of onset, in terms of their progression pattern and speed, in terms of their comorbidities. And yet, most ALS trials treat all patients with ALS as if they have the exact same disease. They treat them in exactly the same way. So for the first time in history, we have a new tool. It's one that's developed by GenieUS, and it's called Deep Integrated Analysis Platform, DIGAP. And as you can read on their website, this really seems to have the potential to categorize patients according to their ALS pathophysiology. And as a result, to be able to personalize their treatment. And so we get the ROAR DIGAP study. This will be a widely inclusive prospective treatment trial in which 50 people with ALS will have their pathophysiology categorized using GenieUS's DIGAP and then receive a personalized treatment for 6 months. We're going to evaluate the safety, tolerability, and efficacy of the treatments using virtual adverse event monitoring, virtual ALS FRSR scores, and neurofilament light chain biomarker levels. There won't be any placebo here. Patients will serve as their own controls. We will also correlate a panel of mechanistic biomarkers with both the DIGAP classification and with the use of each treatment. The participants in this study will be consented and enrolled from both the Duke and the Temple University ALS clinics. And as you can see, the inclusion and exclusion criteria are pretty broad. You can see that there's no exclusion based upon how long you've had the disease, nor what kind of equipment you're using, which is very different from most pharma-sponsored trials. In terms of treatments, we selected products that were associated with at least one ALS reversal and products that have effects on relevant biomarkers at doses that we know are safe and tolerable in humans. So for participants that get into category one, neuroinflammation, we're going to use the carotenoid astaxanthin. For patients in category two, oxidative stress, we're going to use the supplement Protandim. For patients in category three, impaired autophagy and axonal transport, we're going to use the hormone melatonin. And for patients in category four, mitochondrial dysfunction, we're going to use the supplement called MitoQ. And you can read a lot more about each one of those products in the corresponding ALS Untangled review, which is referenced on the slide. In terms of the study schema, I've shown it here. So at time zero, we'll be consenting, screening, and enrolling participants. And from that point on, they will be on standard of care treatments. At that same initial visit, we will obtain blood for a DIGAP sample and a pregnancy test, as well as blood for neurofilament levels and mechanistic biomarkers. Participants will come back 2 months into the study, and they'll receive their DIGAP categorization. And based on that, they will receive their treatment, astaxanthin, Protandim, melatonin, or MitoQ, depending on their category. They will get another blood draw for neurofilament levels and mechanistic biomarkers. 3 months into the study, or 1 month into treatment, there'll be another biomarker panel. And finally, 8 months into the study, 6 months into treatment, there'll be one last biomarker panel. And throughout the study, every month, our coordinators will be making virtual contact by phone or video visit to obtain concomitant medications, adverse events, ALS functional rating scale. In terms of the projected timeline, the protocol is now nearly done. We expect to have it done by the end of February. We're starting the contract process, and we hope to have that done by the end of March. We will then go to the FDA and attempt to get an IND approval, which we hope to have by the end of June. We will then go in front of our Duke and Temple institutional review boards and hope to get those, as well as our departmental approvals, by the end of July. Enrollment, we hope to start in August and will probably go through March of 2024. Last participant will complete the study in November of 2024, and analyses and presentation of results will be in early 2025. So in the end, I want to make sure I thank the people who made all this possible, most importantly, people living with ALS who've inspired me to create this study and who've provided all the funds for it. I want to thank collaborators around the world, especially the GenieUS team, for allowing us to utilize the exciting new DIGAP tool, and Dr. Terry Hyman-Patterson and her team at Temple for helping us to enroll, do statistics, and all the biomarker analyses. And then finally, the teams at the Duke and Temple ALS clinics for helping us to build a foundation of great patient care upon which all our research is built. Thank you for your time and attention. Have a good rest of your day.
Thank you, Dr. Bedlack with Duke ALS and Temple ALS, for taking on this vexing disease. It just points out that it's really important that we generate donations through charity organizations and social media in order to support such research, because big pharmaceutical companies have not had interest in doing clinical trials like Dr. Bedlack is leading. So please visit www.racingforals.com for more information if you'd like to participate. Thanks, and we'll see you on the next video.